Hey gang, so you can probably hear locusts and you can certainly see this incredible panoramic backdrop of a deserted jungle and a deserted beach that I'm on here on location in the Gulf of Thailand, where we are conducting research to understand coral reef fish behavior and how those behaviors feed back to affect coral reefs. But I did want to take just a second to acknowledge something that I've kind of recently come to terms with. And it's this idea of staying true to oneself and taking risks when you see those risks as being essential, I guess, or maybe just something that you think you need to do. So what I'm speaking about particularly is early career scientists, which I am, but I guess I'm not as young as I once was. I'm specifically talking about that stage in your career when you're trying to figure out what you want to study and you're also interested in more than just science, which I think is perfectly normal and natural. And you're trying to figure out how to make sense of all this. You're trying to figure out your research projects. You're trying to figure out how to stay connected with friends and family and to make sure that your research does more than just get published in a scientific peer-reviewed journal that gets read by a handful of experts in many cases. And so I just wanted to give you a very brief anecdote about my own personal experience and why I think it's really essential to follow your gut and not necessarily stick to the sort of cultural expectations that come with a traditional career in science. And I think those traditions are changing, those expectations are changing, to give them credit for the progressiveness that I'm witnessing. But I wanted to just mention, I have struggled for many years throughout my career with everything I just mentioned, trying to figure out exactly what interests me most, what questions should I be asking, how do I stay current with the world around me while I'm often completely isolated in remote locations like where I am right now, virtually cut off from society unless I'm proactive enough to stay connected. How do I deal with all this stuff, right? And I guess I have some hopefully simple tips that have, I think, helped me. And I never got them myself, but I'm giving them to myself now and to you. And one would be just generally follow your interests. And I actually did get that advice. That's easy, right? But like really follow it. That's kind of almost a bogus thing to say. You're like, duh, of course I'll follow my interests. But it's actually not that simple. You get inundated with many, many ideas. There are expectations that get imposed upon you, sometimes subconsciously, sometimes very clearly, explicitly. But as you go through your science career, you often, I think, can become misdirected. And when I say misdirected, I mean directed away from what you really want to be doing. And that's a really challenging thing. And that can often come in the form of you get good at something or you publish some papers on something and people sort of think that's what you do. Like you're a go-to person for that thing. And that's not a bad thing. If you love that and you want to keep doing it, that's actually a great thing. But if it's something you kind of want to move away from and you're sort of those projects and that skill set was sort of something that was a stepping stone for you in your mind, don't be afraid to change. Don't be afraid to try new stuff. Don't be afraid to branch out into new, even sub-disciplines that are vastly different than what you had done in the past. Because I have done that. I kind of went out on a limb with this research looking at fish social information use and how it can feed back to affect this critical ecological process of fish controlling algae on coral reefs, because algae can kill coral reefs as we know them. That whole thing. That was very much tangential from my dissertation research, and it proved to be, I would say, probably the most enjoyable project I've worked on. I formed an incredible collaboration with a dear friend, and it continues to be fruitful. And it's created a heck of a lot of opportunities also, which is really exciting. That's one example, and that's really guiding my research now. Going out on a limb then, which was it was a year and a half before I finished my PhD, and this was distinct from my dissertation research. So I thought, you know, I'm gonna take a risk. I'm gonna just try this because I think it's awesome and it's exciting. And that, you know, it paid off. It doesn't always pay off. And there are many other cases where I've tried something new and exciting and it didn't work out, but this time it did, and it completely changed my career. Very briefly, I also just want to bring up the idea of how you can continue to do more than just science as a researcher, even when you're a grad student and you're completely inundated with so many obligations that are completely science-centric. I would say, generally, you just have to juggle really well, for one. But two, if you have urges to try to connect with family and friends while you're doing the amazing work that you're doing, and it doesn't have to be in an incredible backdrop like I happen to be in right now. It doesn't have to be like that. what you're doing is incredible. You're pushing knowledge forward in some way, in some corner of the scientific world. And because of that, because you're revealing new insights that the human race has never discovered before, that's exciting. And you can make that exciting, especially for people that love you, your friends, your family, and then friends of friends, and that network will only grow. If you want to connect with those people, you now have the ammunition of social media, which is incredibly effective at reaching just unbelievable volumes of viewers and diversities of viewers. Use that. It'll make you feel better. Stay connected. Even if it's something as simple as sending out a tweet describing what you're up to that week with your research in the lab or on your computer or in the field, it will help you to feel connected. And putting that kind of information out there only helps build the bridge between the public and science, a bridge that is in sore need of infrastructural reinforcement, so to speak. And if you can contribute to that by connecting with the folks closest to you first and then branching out from there, I think that can be incredibly fulfilling. So that's just an example of a non-traditional science activity that I think, if you think you want to do it, I think you should do it. Don't overdo it, but don't underdo it also. And the only bit I'll say about that is I did that too. I tend to videotape a lot while I'm in the field. If you followed my YouTube channel, you know that. That's where this stuff comes from. And it's easy to do that. Throw a camera on your head or on your chest with GoPros, or have one in your hand, and you know, videotape what you're seeing. And so much of the stuff you do and see when you're a scientist is stuff that the world just doesn't know about. And I think it's, to some degree, I think it's your obligation to share it. But I actually also think it's maybe even more valuable to say you'll probably feel better when you do share it. And I too have followed that trajectory a little bit throughout my career. And more and more as I've kind of just become more confident and sort of just had it with sticking to the expectation that I should only do science. So now I do both. I am a field ecologist. I also work on a computer a lot. But in addition to those things, I like to share this experience with the world. And all of these things, I think, have created a career at this point right now when I'm employed, where I'm very happy and fulfilled. So, and those two things are really defining, going out on a limb and finding this new research topic that I love and that I now pursue full time for my research. And then also kind of going out on a limb and trying to just do outreach semi-regularly. Those two have become really big centerpieces to my current career. And I honestly wouldn't change any of it. I love it. It's been incredibly fulfilling. And it's because I followed my gut. It took me longer to follow it than I would have liked, but eventually I followed my gut. And I think that's the best thing I can offer to young scientists is to say exactly that. And maybe a step before that is really think and you know, be completely honest with yourself with what your gut is telling you and try to filter out what other people are saying. Even people that care about you, because the only one who knows you as well as they possibly can is you. So, little piece of advice for young scientists. I think it's paid off for me, and hopefully it will pay off for you someday.